Data is one of those things that makes the world go round. Everything uses data, just think about it for a second. From the device in your pocket, social media, the store down the street, down to the large enterprise and governments, everyone has data, and that means that everyone needs to store that data someplace. So for the next few minutes, I want to talk to you about all the recent updates to storage in Azure. I'm Dean Cifola, and this is the Azure Academy. Azure Storage is a fully managed platform service in the cloud that is highly scalable in size and performance, can be backed up and protected from disasters with the press of a button, it's accessible anywhere in the world, and you can build it in just seconds. And there are many different offerings for Azure Storage, so let's look at the documentation. And in case you don't know, the quick link to get here is aka.ms/Azure Docs. And when you get here, we'll scroll down and go to the storage section on the left. And here are all of the different offerings around Azure Storage. And these break down into a few different families. We have the storage that's related to high performance compute, and that's the FXT storage and HPC cache. Then we have storage related to data operations like Data Lake and Azure Data Shares. And then we have these storage account related items like archive storage, Azure Files, Blob storage, queue and table storage. And then we have the on-prem services like Databox and Store Simple. So there's a lot of different ways that you can interact with storage in the cloud, so how you do it really depends on your workload. So we're gonna start off with Blob storage here, and let's go over to the Azure portal. I've got a resource group called Blob Replication, and in here I've got two storage accounts in the Canada East region, and that's where these preview features are enabled. So if I go into the first storage account to containers, I've got a container called test, and then another one here that's called $blobchangeFeed, and changeFeed is one of the preview features. And there's two other features that are also being used here, and that is indexing and object replication. So if I go into the test container, you see I've got two different files. And if we look back at the other storage account, I've also got a container here called test where I have the two same files. So how am I able to do this? Well, if I go to the storage account and I scroll down to the blob services section, we have a new feature flag that you can enable called object replication. And here's where you can set up replication rules to asynchronously copy data from one container to another across multiple storage accounts and across multiple Azure regions. Now in the docs under the blob storage section, in the filter, you can just type object replication and then click the first link. And this tells you how object replication works and that it is something that is asynchronous. And on the right here, we've got a link for about the preview telling you what regions you can enable this in and that there are other things that go along with object replication like blob versioning, change feed, and then you can also use another feature called indexing. And this makes your storage account much more powerful. Rather than just being able to contain your data, it actually can help you to manage your data. And then down here in the register for the preview section, you've got the PowerShell to directly run and set up your storage account. And so all I did was I copied this code and then ran this in my PowerShell, and I waited for all of the providers to be registered, and then I was able to go in and create the storage account and use this feature. So you can see I've already got an object replication rule here replicating from blob rep 000 over to this account, which is 001. And I can click over here on the three dots to edit the rule. So starting at the top, you can see we've got our source storage account, which is 000. Destination is 001, and then the particular rule for the container. My source and destination were both called test, but they didn't have to be. They could have been called anything, and I'm not using any filters. So let me show you how this works. We're going to go and create a new container, and I'll call this Azure Academy and hit create. And inside my new container, I'll click upload and upload some files. And here's some JSON documents, and we'll click open and then upload those. And then I have to go to the other storage account and create a container here to receive those items. And I can call this whatever I want, and I'll just call it replicated and hit create. All right, so let's go back to the source storage account, and we'll scroll down in the left here to blob services and object replication. And notice that I've deleted my replication rules so I could show you the whole process. At the top, we click setup replication. And we have to enter our destination details, starting with our subscription and then our storage account. Then we select our source container, in this case Azure Academy, and our destination, which is replicated. Then if there are any filters that we want, we can add them here as well. And I'll enter the word Azure here, because I had one file that started with Azure. All the rest of them start with the word desktop. And then you can use the copy over feature to determine how you want to copy things, either copy everything in the account or only new objects from here on, or you can have your own custom replication settings. I'm going to just choose to copy everything and we'll hit save. Now remember, everything in this case is everything that matches our filter, okay? So I'm not moving every file over, just the ones that match. And then you can write other things here if you want as well, like I could put back my test folder. And notice the copy over here is only new objects. So I've got to upload a new object into my source account before it will replicate to my destination. And then I'll just hit save and apply. And there are our two rules. So I'll click under the source containers here, my test folder, since I need to upload a new file before it's going to replicate. And I'll click the upload, go to select a new file, and then I'll just copy in some PowerShell files and upload those. And that completed successfully. So if I go back to the object replication, I can navigate from here to my destination container. And just be aware that it may not happen immediately because it is an asynchronous process. And there's all of our PowerShell files now. If I go to my replicated folder, we can see in there that it has finished the copy of my JSON file because it began with the word Azure. So it met my filter condition and replicated the file over. Back in the replication rules, I can click to edit the rule set, and I'll change my filter here and I'll delete the word Azure so that it copies over everything in the account. I'll hit save and apply. And if I go back to the replicated folder, still hasn't come over yet, might take another minute. Oh, there it is. Everything is now replicated. So this very easily allows you to have control over replicating data in your Blob storage accounts, however it is that you want to manage it, from account to account or from container to container, even across multiple regions. So I'm going to go back to my Azure Academy source container and I'm going to delete a few files here, the ones that are the desktop workspace contributor. There we go, those are gone. So now my replication of my deletes should also carry over. So let's flip back to our destination container that's called replicated. And those have deleted now as well. So if we go back to our source storage account, we want to turn on another feature here, and it's down in the blob services area under data protection, and that would be the soft delete feature. Now, soft delete not only will protect us from files that are deleted, but also files that are overwritten. And here's also where you can enable the versioning and change feed. And those are requirements for replication, which would have happened when you did the initial PowerShell. So with this enabled, we can go back to our container. So if I click this button up here to show our deleted blobs, there's our three that were deleted. And if I wanted to restore one of these files, I could just click on the three dots and go to view the previous versions, find the particular version of the file that I want, let's say this one, and click to make it the current version, and that'll bring it back from the delete. Of course, another thing that we can do is snapshots, and we can create a snapshot of any of the files that are here, which I have done. And then you can click on the individual file and view any of the snapshots. And depending on the file type, you can even go into edit here and you can manipulate the file, but that's going to be specific to the kind of file that it is. There's also the concept of axis tiers, and so I can check on this snapshot and go to change the tier, and I can go from hot to cool to archive, and doing that can dramatically reduce the cost of retaining the data, but understand that there is a performance penalty the colder you get. So let's transition here from blob storage into files. And to do that, we're going to talk about a feature that is for both of these services, and that is called Private Link. Private Link allows you to set up an IP address on your private Azure virtual network that is representative of that service. So in the case of storage, you would have the IP address of 10.1.1.5, and that represents Azure storage in your account. We then disable the public internet endpoint, and the only way to communicate with it is over your private endpoint. So back in our storage account, in the main part of the blade, we'll scroll down a little bit to the settings section, and you can see private endpoint connections is here. And at the top, you can click to add a private endpoint. And when you do, you first choose your subscription and then your resource group, just like all other Azure resources. And I'll call this instance private blobs, and it's in Canada East because that's where my storage account is. And we'll click next for my resources. And in the resource types, this is all of the platform services. So here we need to find storage. And notice that there are two options. There's storage accounts, and then there is the storage sync service. And this is Azure Files Sync. And if you're unfamiliar with that service, go and check out our video on Azure Files Sync on the top here. A great way to bring your on-prem file server information into the cloud and turn your file servers into hot file caches. But here we'll just choose our storage accounts. And then for our resource, we'll pick the individual storage account that we want. And because storage accounts have many different kinds of resources, we can even isolate down to blobs in this case. And we'll click next for our configuration, and we've got our network already set up, and I've got a subnet selected here for this as well. And at the bottom, we have our private DNS integration. And this is going to create for us an Azure private DNS resource, and it's going to register our storage accounts blob service as that resource with an IP address. And we'll hit next and then add our tags, and everything looks like we're good to go. So let's create. While that's going on, we'll go to our other storage account and we'll go to add a new file share, and we'll click the file share at the top and we can give it a name. And then we have the quota, and this is how large of a file share we want to create. And if I try to create a share that is 10 terabytes in size, we've got a problem. And that is that we can only create one that's up to 5 terabytes in size. Now this is the default behavior in our storage accounts, but there is a way to fix this. So we'll discard those changes, and in the settings section of the blade, we'll go to configuration. And here's where you can change all of the behaviors around the storage account. We have a feature called large file shares, and this is the one that's going to help us solve the 5 terabyte issue. By enabling large file shares, we can go as high as 100 terabytes. So I'll hit save for that. And let's go back to our file share now and create that new share. And now when we put in our 10 terabytes, no problem. How about we go to 100? No problem. Can we go bigger than 100? Nope, 100 is the maximum. All right, so I'll just create a 100 terabyte file share, and there we go. Created just in 1 second. So now that that's created, let me go through and set up the private link for that. And where we go to select our sub target resource, we'll be selecting files here, and we'll click next for our configuration. And we want this to be on our files subnet. And we will again set up a private DNS zone and then add our tags and then review and create. And now that that's complete, we have our two private endpoints. Each one of them corresponds to the network card, and that network card is what gives them the IP addresses on our private virtual network. And then we have our two DNS zones. So first, let's take a look at our network. There's the two network cards and their IP addresses for blobs and files. And if we go to one of the DNS zones, in the center here, we've got our SOA record and also the IP address from that network card that we just created, which is registered in this zone. And then over on the left, we can see that it is linked over to our virtual network. So that enables you to talk to this storage account privately. But we're not yet complete because we still have the internet-facing endpoint that we need to disable. And for that, we go into the storage account. And on the left here, we go to the firewall and virtual network. And you see by default that this is enabling from all networks, and that does include the internet. So we want to turn this to selected networks. And now the question is, which networks need access to this storage account? So we need to add those Azure virtual networks up top, as well as anything else from on-prem that we need to gain access. So this could be your front-end netted public IP address from on-prem, or the IP for your virtual network gateway's connection on-prem, or an individual client IP. So I'll check the box here to add my client IP, and I'll click the plus to add my existing virtual network, select the correct subscription, and then the virtual network itself, and then select which particular subnet I want to allow, in this case, the blob, and then we'll click enable. And now that has been enabled, we'll click add to complete the process. You click save, and let's go and repeat that on our other storage account. And we'll click add for that as well. And then at the end of all that, you click save, and that'll change the configuration on the storage account. And with that complete, the only way to access the blob or files from these storage accounts is over our private IP address. So going back to the storage account with our file share in it, two other things that have been improved. We now have soft delete enabled to protect our file shares, and this is a storage account level process. So we'll open up my file share here, and I'll just upload all these files. Okay, and that is complete. Now, in a file share, you can also change the size of the share itself, either up or down. So I'm going to go here from having 100 terabytes down to just having 1 terabyte. And again, that process just happens instantly. And file shares have multiple ways of being protected as well. So under snapshots, we can just take a snapshot here of our share, and that is of the entire file share as is. And there you can see all of the individual files. So if we go back to the overview and I was to delete a couple, and now I need to retrieve them, so I could go to my snapshot and then go and retrieve them from here. And so I'll take this workbat file and just click on the three dots and hit restore. And when you do, you can choose to overwrite the existing file or file name if it was present, or you could give it a new one, and I'll call this restored1.bat and hit OK. And if we go back to the file share itself, there is our restored file. That protects the files inside the share. What happens if the whole file share gets destroyed? Oops, it's gone. What do I do now? So I see the show deleted shares button. So if I click that, oh, nope, nothing here. How do I set this up? So in the main blade, I've got to scroll down to the file service section, and here's where soft delete is located. So I've got to enable this here and then set my retention, which is 7 days by default, and I'll hit save for that. This is again a setting for the entire storage account. I'll create a new share, call this share 2, create that 1 terabyte share again, we'll upload those files. Now I'll just go and delete the share again. And now I can go and hit the show deleted shares. So if we click on the three dots and do the undelete, it is now restored. And we can click in the share and there's all of our data. So we can protect the individual files in the share with a snapshot. We can certainly protect it with Azure Backup, but now soft delete also enables us to protect the entire file share. So another way to manage and control your share. One benefit that I didn't mention yet in file shares is that the individual file sizes that you could upload has now increased to 4 terabytes. So that means now you can store things like VHD files on your file shares. Think about things like FS Logics and storing things like App Attach in the near future. And with the individual file size of 4 terabytes now, we should be able to, for the foreseeable future, accommodate any applications or profile issues and other file data that you need. And speaking of use cases like FS Logics, if we scroll back up in the blade to our configuration, of course, we have done a video already on using AD authentication with your storage accounts. So go check that out in the top if you had missed that. And this feature has also recently been made generally available. So now you can get your file shares for FS Logics, Windows Virtual Desktop, or any other use case involving an Azure file share authenticated to your Active Directory. That can all be secured with a private endpoint and keep your user profile safe. So I hope you've enjoyed looking at this storage roundup and all of the new features that have recently become available in preview or generally available for use in storage accounts. All different ways that Microsoft is enhancing the management of the platform so that you can do what you do best. And if you like this video or learned something new today, go ahead and click that thumbs up and let me know that you appreciated our content. And please feel free to share this video with others who would benefit from it, as well as subscribe if you haven't done that already. And join us here at our community, where we're just trying to help everybody learn all they can about Azure. And if you have any questions about today's video or any comments on anything around Azure or something that you'd like to see in a future video, give me that in the comments field down below and we'll get to work on that right away. And if you're looking for something new to watch, over here on the right, we've got our latest video as well as one we've selected just for you. Thanks for joining us for today's video, and we will see you soon. Happy learning.